Welcome, everybody, to the NRF Foundation Recruiter Chat panel with Nordstrom, PetSmart, and Ross Stores. We are so excited to have you all here for our very first Recruiter Chat of the season. My name is Analeah Sudrumauer. I am the Director of Programs for the NRF Foundation team, and I'm joined here by my colleague Samantha Lamanna, who is also from the NRF Foundation and will be here supporting in the chat for anything that you all might need during the session. The Recruiter Chats are part of a larger virtual event series hosted by the NRF Foundation, all designed to help you as students make connections with retail recruiters and hopefully get hired for your next internship or full-time job in retail, and to gain a better understanding of all the opportunities that are out there while expanding your professional networks. From today until September 28th, we will be hosting Recruiter Chat panels at 5 p.m. Eastern. Three or four different retailers. And the focus for this session is for you all to learn more about each company, their jobs, and the experiences that you can gain from working for them. All of these panels will lead to our virtual career fair on Friday, October 6th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Eastern, where you'll have a chance to meet one-on-one with recruiters from all of the companies participating in the recruiter panels. So make sure that you're signing up for that virtual career fair so you have the chance to continue the conversation with these amazing companies. And then lastly, we'll wrap up our fall programming with a mentorship series called Fostering Diverse Connections, sponsored by Ross, created for students of color. This unique mentorship event will bring together diverse students and executives from across the retail industry to network and build relationships. You can find all of the information at the signup links on our website, and Samantha will be sharing those in the chat as we speak. So we hope to see you participate in those as well as in today's session. All of this amazing virtual programming leads up to our in-person student program conference in New York City, taking place January 11 to 14, 2024, where you will also see almost all of these participating companies attending with us in New York as well. But for now, we are here to talk to Nordstrom, PetSmart, and Ross. So we will start with very brief introductions and an overview of the companies, as well as the opportunities they're recruiting for, and then dive into the questions. So starting off with brief introductions, let's have Manuel start, then Samantha, and then Brittany.
Well, hi, everyone. My name is Manuel Ramos. I am the recruiter on the emerging talent team here at PetSmart at our Phoenix home office. We are recruiting for our summer 2024 internships currently. Those are going to be across various departments, including IT, finance, supply chain, buying, merchandising, proprietary brands, and the like. And as I mentioned, summer 2024 internships, we typically look for rising juniors and seniors. It's a 10-week paid internship here in Phoenix. A big kind of a separator of us amongst our peers is we also offer relocation benefits as well as paid housing while you're here for all 10 weeks. So that's not anything that you need to worry about. And happy to chat with you all.
Hi, everybody. I'm Sam Michnick. I am a senior college recruiter at Ross. I've been here for a little over 6 years now, and I've always been on the recruiting side. And just a little bit about Ross. I'm not sure if everybody has heard of Ross, but we are an off-price retail company that really focuses on kind of delivering name brand and high quality merchandise at a 20 to 60% discount off of specialty stores, you know, department stores and other retailers. So we are an $18.7 billion company, and we've been operating for over 40 years. So we have a few different chains that we operate. We have Ross Dress for Less and DD's Discounts. And then we have our headquarters in California out in the Bay Area. And then we have three buying offices located in New York, Los Angeles, and Boston. And I am located in the New York office. And I specifically recruit for our New York and our LA internship program, and then run the program as well.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brittany Thomas, and I am a program manager here at Nordstrom. I've been with the company now for a little over 12 years. And so for those of you who are unfamiliar with Nordstrom, we are one of the leading fashion retailers here in the U.S. We started off as a very small shoe company in 1901, and we've kind of evolved to service customers in all aspects, from men, women, kids, to pets, home goods and all. We carry it all. And so I am here recruiting for our summer 2024 internships that include cybersecurity, finance, corporate supply chain, fashion design, and software engineering. Nice to meet you all.
And Manuel and Brittany, you touched on this, but Samantha, do you want to quickly share the opportunities you're recruiting for, both internships and or full-time?
Absolutely. Yeah. So we are recruiting for internships for summer 2024 in buying and planning. And we're also recruiting. So those are for juniors, I should mention. And we are also recruiting seniors for entry-level positions, also in buying and planning in our buying offices.
Great. Thank you. All right. So for our first question, what skills and or experiences are each of you looking for in candidates? What would you say are the 1 to 2 soft skills that students should be focusing on now to stand out in the process? We'll start with Brittany and then Samantha and then Manuel.
Sure. Okay, I'll keep it brief. I would say that we look for a strong ability to like effectively communicate, strong eye for attention to detail. Overall, I look for potential. I don't need a ton of experience from you, right? I'm not seeking perfection, but just think of like, what are some transferable skill sets that we could potentially enhance as a result of you coming to work at Nordstrom?
I totally agree with that. We're really looking for potential. You know, we're not looking for somebody who's already experienced and molded. You know, we really want someone who just comes to the table with that eagerness to learn, that excitement and passion for the industry. I would say that that's definitely our number one soft skill that my team is really looking for when we are interviewing. You know, I would say hard skills, you know, analytical skills, including Excel is something that's super important to the business. So kind of that ability to draw conclusions, you know, connect the dots in terms of a business perspective. But, you know, soft skills, we're really looking for that passion for retail and that passion for, you know, really, I guess, more that eagerness to learn and grow and develop. You know, that's really important to our culture. It's really important to, you know, our talent growth.
I would definitely echo what my colleagues have definitely mentioned in terms of soft skills. We definitely don't look for expert levels, as Brittany mentioned, but what we do look for is learning agility. We're looking for how do you navigate yourself in a pretty ambiguous environment, right? Retail is ever changing on a daily basis. So how do you display that learning agility? We can always teach and refine hard skills. We cannot, unfortunately, or maybe we can impact, but maybe just not as drastically those soft skills, right? So how do you engage with your leaders? How do you ask for what you need? I think a lot of students struggle with how to bridge that kind of transition from a very structured, syllabified, focused environment to a very ambiguous role. So how do you just ask for what you need? That's what we definitely strive for.
Thank you all for sharing those. And kind of an evolution of this first question, you know, we received a lot of questions from students specifically about their resumes. I think there's a lot of pressure when working on resumes and in just one page, getting it all in there. So in each of your professional opinion and, you know, is your expertise as recruiters, what would you say are the top 3 things that you're looking to see on a candidate's resume? Samantha, we'll start with you on this, and then Manuel, and then Brittany.
Thanks. So to Annalea's point, it should be one page. It should not be flowing over to a different page. It's, you know, pare it down if you feel like you're going on to another page. But, you know, to Brittany's point before, we're looking for potential. I'm not expecting anyone to have a previous internship, you know, at the intern level. I'm not expecting anyone to come in with, you know, years of experience in retail. I do want to see some sort of retail exposure, whether that's in school, in your major, or in any like classes that you've taken. If it's not your direct major, maybe some clubs that you're in on campus and organizations you're a part of. So anything that says you're interested in retail. If you don't have any of that, you know, I would maybe put it in an objective or something like that. So that's definitely, you know, one thing I'm certainly looking for. And always put your graduation date. I know that, you know, it's important, especially for internships. We want to know when you're graduating. So definitely put that. But other than that, I mean, I'm really looking for, you know, a clean, well-organized, resume with, you know, no grammatical errors or anything like that. But content wise, it's just like really that clear interest in retail that's important to me.
Yeah, very well put. To add to that, I think an embellishment that a lot of students struggle with is how do you put down that relevant experience? And so I think a large misconception is that work experience, roles that have garnished you a paycheck. I would challenge all of you to look at your current curriculum, your past classes that you've taken. I would much rather hear about a course that exposed you to a program or a train of thought or presented you with a project scope that forced you outside of your comfort level rather than hearing you've been a golf caddy at a country club for 3 years. Certainly, that will exist on your LinkedIn, things of that nature. But give me that relevant experience to what you're looking to accomplish in your internship, and that includes the classes that you're taking. None of us were born with heavy analytical skills. So how did you garnish that Excel, maybe Python or R data synthesizing skill sets, right? As much as I'd love to say I wasn't just naturally gifted with them, that was not the case. But how do you verbalize that in your resume? Additionally, keep it relevant. There's a really solid website that I'm a big fan of. It's called jobscan.co. It allows you to kind of cross-reference and draw a little bit of analysis between the job description you're applying to and your resume to give you some of those key terms or phrases that appear in the job description, because oftentimes you have the skill set. It's just a matter of wordsmithing it or restructuring a sentence to really convey that skill set. In addition, if you are a technical student, either a graphic designer, a digital student, an engineer, if you will, and you have a GitHub or an online portfolio, please link that to your digital resume. I'm in HR because I'm nosy, so I want to see the things. Plus, it also may convey a much more clean explanation to your skill set to the hiring manager that makes maybe a little bit more finessed in the world that you're going to be working in.
Gosh, I don't think Manuel and Samantha left me much to say. But again, when I'm looking at resumes, I do look at club and organization involvement, because that just kind of speaks to your potential exposure to like leadership, depending on the role that you hold. Projects that you've worked on is a huge one for me. And ones that are maybe outside of a classroom setting, right? Because it kind of speaks to your motivation and your ability to follow through. And then just, you know, leaning in on those transferable skill sets. Like, you may not have held the roles that I'm recruiting for technically, right, by name. But, you know, those transferable skill sets, I look at to see if, you know, that potential is there for either the role that I'm recruiting for, or maybe I would tap you to see if you're interested in something completely different from what you applied for. And then lastly, like when describing your accomplishments, using like strong, captivating words like create or pioneered, things like that kind of catch my eye. So.
All very good advice. Thank you all for sharing that. I'm sure it's appreciated as everyone is working on their resumes to start their applications. In the evolution of that, once they've done their resume and they've applied and they're starting the process with each of you, how can applicants, whether it's for internships or for entry level, stand out throughout the recruiting process or even at the very beginning of their jobs? Manuel, we'll start with you and then Brittany and then Samantha.
I'm honestly just a really big fan of just organic relationship building. So whether that be through an email outreach, or maybe we messaged you on Handshake, or you encountered us at a career fair, just truly create those, you know, navigate those natural relationships that emerge and nurture them. So if you add me on LinkedIn or whatnot, reach out if you see something that's posted, or if I post, interact with that. Definitely display that more of those soft skill culture aspects of what we can expect from you as an associate. But just regular engagement is never a bad thing. It keeps you front of mind. But also make sure that the resume is one of those things that kind of adds to it, right? So asking for what you need when you need it. As strong as I like to think I am as a recruiter, I can't read minds. So just definitely asking for what you need if information is not clear or afforded to you right up front.
Yeah, I think for me, I hear a lot of like, I love fashion. I have a passion for fashion. I've been shopping at Nordstrom since I was a child. And that's probably literally in 95% of the answers that I hear as to why candidates are interested in Nordstrom, which is fine, right? I don't take away from those candidates and their experiences and love for fashion. But I feel like if you want to stand out in the recruiting process with us, like I would be prepared to speak to the impact that fashion has had on you. How does what you're studying intersect with fashion? And then with that, what value could you bring to Nordstrom as an intern or an entry-level employee? And then most importantly, just be authentic. Like authentically yourself. Like we pride ourselves on creating an environment where employees can bring their whole selves to work. And so we definitely want to see that in the recruiting process and certainly when you join us as well.
I definitely agree with that authenticity piece. We want to see the real you. We want to make sure that it's a good fit on our end and it's a good fit for you, you know. You don't want to end up somewhere that's not the right place for you because you didn't really show your true self during the interview process. So I definitely echo that. I think for me, during the interview process, the candidates that stand out the most are really the ones that are really prepared. They're really, they did their research on the job, on the company. They really know what they're interviewing for. And then the ones that prepare good questions. So not just the surface level questions, but really questions that kind of show their curiosity and show that kind of genuine interest and excitement for the role. I think that those are the people that really stand out because, again, you know, that's something that is really important for our culture. And I think also it's not easy to teach those things. It's not easy to teach curiosity or teach engagement and excitement. So we really want to see that. And I definitely want to see that up front during the interview process. And then again, you know, same thing when you start on the job, I think it's continuing to ask those questions, kind of showing up engaged, excited, eager to learn. Those are really the people who are most successful at Ross.
Great. Thank you all really good advice. And, you know, definitely important as many applications as you all are working on. You know, I think we've all been there and just trying to apply for so many jobs, but taking the time to know exactly what you're interviewing for, researching that specific company can make the difference. And looking at your interviewers, taking that time to do the research on them too, so that you are being intentional. It's not just another interview you're checking off the list, but being really meaningful with those interviews is really an important part of the process. So moving on to the next question, what do possible career paths look like for interns and entry-level hires at your company? Brittany, we'll start with you first for this one, and then Samantha, and then Manuel.
Thanks, Analea. I think, so this question is a little, not tricky, but there's so many different career paths that you can take just depending on the role. So this obviously could look really different, but generally speaking, at Nordstrom, like we have a promote from within philosophy, which creates endless opportunities. So my career path, for example, I started as a salesperson, went on to lead and manage my own sales teams. And then in 2014, I pivoted into HR and held various roles from an HR assistant to a coordinator and then an HR manager across several different locations in the Northeast. And then pivoted into full cycle recruiting for tech, which I had literally no idea about the world of technology, right? And so now I'm a program manager. So really, I feel like my career path is just kind of a testament to, you know, our promote from within philosophy. So there's no really straight answer for this. I can give you examples of what I've seen. So like, for instance, a retail management intern would convert into an assistant department manager after the program is over. And I know since then, many of them have been promoted to running their own departments as a department manager. Or on the other hand, in the technology space, I've had software engineering interns convert into entry-level engineers and then later be promoted to an engineer too. And the next step would be an engineering manager. So honestly, it varies, but there's plenty of opportunity for growth.
We also have a lot of opportunity for growth. We have a similar program called Grow Our Own. And essentially, you know, the whole goal of our internship and entry-level programs is to really, you know, convert our interns into full-time hires and to really just continue that growth path. And we do have very clearly defined kind of career paths in both buying and planning. We sort of have different stages, you're doing different things. So the first role is a learning role. The next level up would be an applying role, then ownership, and then leadership. So there really is that kind of defined career path. Of course, there's flexibility, you know, if you want to raise your hand and learn about something else. But, you know, growth is such a big part of our culture, and it's such a big pillar. And personally, what I've loved so much about working at Ross is really that growth potential. And, you know, it's not uncommon to see that people at Ross have been here, you know, 10, 20, 30 years, which is just really exciting to see. And I think that it really motivates our interns and entry-level associates for sure.
Yeah, I would definitely echo what Samantha said in terms of tenure that you encounter as you're navigating through the hallways, whether it's at home office, at our DCs, or at any of our actual stores. To hear 15, 20, 30, you know, 30 years of experience, considering, you know, we're a company that was founded in the 80s, is really, really impressive to see. So from an internship perspective, we have four different rotational programs. They each vary in length, but we have a rotational program within supply chain, our merchant space, our digital and marketing spaces. And so after graduation, an intern would go back to school, or excuse me, let me go back. After the internship is wrapped, our interns would go back to school for at least one or two additional semesters, during which point we would extend an offer. If that right fit was a match and there is a headcount available, we extend an offer to return as a full-time salaried employee under one of these rotational programs. At the end of the rotational program, you are then interviewing and going to be placed in one of the teams that you had rotated within. In addition to that, there's a lot of opportunity to cross-functionally collaborate with other teams, which gains you exposure to their teams, allows you to complete a stretch assignment or a stretch project within that team to really kind of ensconce yourself within that team. It allows you to gain the familiarity and vice versa. They get to know you and how you work should you have not have interacted with them during your internship. But a ton of different career paths. Right off the top of my head, I can think of one of our buying interns a few years back has navigated a variety of different departments. She's one of those classic double, triple majors that exist out there, right? You have a multitude of different faceted interests. So how can you say yes to the role in front of you, give your whole self, right, which includes all of those various interests, and interject those in the work that you accomplish to really allow not just your immediate sphere of influence, but anyone else who might encounter that, an idea of what you're capable of and when you're able to bring to the table. So definitely always say yes to opportunity. Always, you know, especially if you're not familiar with it and it pushes you outside of that comfort zone, say yes to learning an additional skill set. That might be the assignment that clearly defines, ooh, I love this, or you know what, I'm real good. I'm going to go this route instead.
Perfect. Thank you all. So next question, what is one highlight of the intern or new hire experience at your company that you would want to share with the audience? And Samantha, we'll have you kick this one off, and then Manuel and Brittany.
So I think that the biggest highlight that we usually hear from interns and entry-level hires is our structured training and development programs. I think that our onboarding plans are really something unique to Ross. I think that we are really thoughtful about how we approach the learning and development of new hires. I think that it's a very well built out program. It's a full 8 weeks for any new hire that starts with us, no matter what level. So you really get a chance to kind of get up and running, get up to speed before you're kind of thrown into the role. And we constantly hear that from people. And I think it is something that sets us apart.
I would say a major highlight is just accessibility to senior leaders. Obviously, my team and all of HR, very excited for interns. But what I love most and most more than anything is once you land, whether you're in buying, whether you're in supply chain, whether you're in IT or in marketing, any senior leader is so incredibly generous and gracious with their time, their knowledge. So the accessibility piece, I think, is a huge component. We also have, you know, scheduled lunches with our CEO where he sits down with all of the interns and we kind of break them up in smaller groups. So that way it becomes a little bit more of an intimate lunch rather than you're one of X amount of interns. As it is, our intern program is pretty boutique. We'll be welcoming 39 interns this upcoming summer. So that'll be like two lunches worth of 20 interns with our CEO or whomever is joining us from a senior leadership perspective.
I think for us at Nordstrom, the level of mentorship and really hands-on experience is unmatched. You know, you work on real projects that impact real customers. The level of mentorship that I've personally experienced has really pioneered my career. I'd also say the exposure and opportunities that you have to really engage with our executives, such as like the CEOs and VPs, is incredible. And then, you know, as I mentioned earlier, like the rich culture, that's another bonus, supportive with like a strong sense of, you know, belonging, such an inclusive, fun environment. And then not to mention the juicy merchandise discount that we get as well at our full line stores, racks and coffee shops and restaurants. So.
Love that. Thank you all for sharing. All right. Final question for our panelists, and then we will open it up to our audience for questions. So start thinking about all of your questions. But before we get to that, in your personal experience, what guidance would you offer to students right now on identifying if an employer is the right fit for them? Manuel, we'll have you go first, then Brittany, then Samantha.
Sure. My biggest piece of advice when it comes to this, you've heard all three of us kind of speak to culture and what you can expect when you come to work, right? I would strongly suggest make a list of just absolute non-negotiables for you that you're not willing to sacrifice or bend on as it relates to what you're looking for in your employer. I landed in retail at the ripe old age of 17, early 2000s, and NSYNC was still a thing back then for all of the recent emergence. And I'm still vying for that reunion tour. I will be the first in line. But that being said, different time and place, right? So for me, having worked at a variety of different organizations and companies and really industries, you know, Brittany touched on this earlier, coming to work as your true authentic self, for me, includes sometimes coming to work with a little bit of a manicure on, or I got a perm last year. I have no texture to my hair, but I wanted it and I got it. Or I'll come to work, like I'm wearing jeans and Birkenstocks right now. You're able to come to work as your true authentic self because at the end of the day, the jobs that I'm posting and recruiting for are not impacted by what color my nails are or what's on my feet in terms of shoe wear, right? You come to work as your true authentic self. That is going to translate immensely in your job quality and the project scopes that you present in your engagement with senior leaders and executives across the organization that will always authentically translate. So list of non-negotiables, that is 100% where I would start.
I think my answer sort of piggybacks off of Manuel's, like, you know, do your research and ask questions about the company culture and its values. You know, do they align with your own morals and values? Ask how they promote work-life integration, right? For their employees. Like, don't be afraid to ask those kinds of questions because you want to be able to get an idea of whether or not you and the company will be culturally and morally compatible. And I believe that this is super important because in full transparency, there will be times where you'll spend more time working than with your own family. So you definitely want to ensure that where you're working is a place that you'll truly enjoy.
I'm definitely gonna piggyback off of these two answers. But I think that a way that you can kind of find out a little bit more, dig a little bit deeper as it relates to, you know, seeing if the company culture non-negotiables are in place, seeing, you know, kind of asking those questions during the interview process, really network with people and reach out to anyone you might know at the companies that you're interested in to find out more about their culture from somebody who actually works there, you know, not someone who's recruiting you, someone who can kind of just tell you, you know, the inside scoop. I think that it is, it's really important to be asking those questions to find your perfect fit and make sure that, you know, you're checking off those non-negotiables. Maybe you're checking off some of those want to haves or nice to haves. And I think it's important to kind of do that in a few ways. So I think networking is one of the ways to kind of get those answers.
Great. All amazing answers, amazing advice. I feel like I learned so much. So I hope all of you did as well. We have a number of questions in the chat. So I'm going to start working through those first. And then we will ask all of you to raise your hand, use the raise hand feature on Zoom. If you'd like to introduce yourself and ask your question, you can go ahead and start raising your hand and we'll go in order. Or of course, you can continue to use the chat if that is more comfortable. So I'm going to read these questions out loud and then any three of you, feel free to jump in. There's one right at the very top of just what about graduate level students? Anything you all want to add for grad students, any entry level roles or other resources they could check out at your companies for potential jobs?
For us, it really just depends on graduation date. We don't have any specific like MBA or graduate programs, but you know, kind of based on when they would be eligible to work, you know, full time is kind of what would determine their eligibility for the internship or just directly into a full time role. So it really just depends on graduation date.
I would definitely agree with that. Our internships are specifically geared toward undergrads specifically. That being said, the primary reason for that is just the pay bands, right? The pay bands of the actual internship as well as the roles that you're potentially going to be migrating into should an offer be extended. Those are pretty finite. So just if depending on what your parameters are, we have hired graduate students in the past, MBA students in the past. We've also hired, you know, sophomores in the past. So there's not really a firm line there, but it's more so about the content of your resume. And if it's a good match from a variety of different aspects, you know, but a lot of that is handled through just conversations, clarifying questions. But ultimately for us, our hiring managers make that decision.
Yeah. And I think it's along the same lines for us as well. It's like a combination of Samantha and Manuel's answers as well. But we do have three programs that are geared specifically towards graduating seniors. We have our retail leadership training program. So if you're like wanting to become a department manager at one of our stores, that would be fitting for you. We have our supply chain leadership training program as well that, you know, gears you, kind of revs you up for like operations management at, you know, one of our warehouses. And then we have restaurant leadership training. So there's two different tracks. There's one for a chef, and then there's also one for general management as well. And then we also have our finance rotational program, and that's a 3-year commitment for that program.
Brittany, could you repeat quickly what positions you were hiring for at the very beginning, the intern roles? This question was asked at the top of the meeting. So I think just repeating, I think you listed 4 of them.
Yeah. So we have internships for cybersecurity, software engineering, fashion design, and supply chain.
Great. Thank you. So that leads to the next question written by Thomas. He said, it sounded like supply chain interns was something all we're looking for. Can you all speak to what is a key skill for a role in this department that would help us stand out? So Brittany, and then I think Manuel, you also had said supply chain, if you want to address that one.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have any skill sets specific to supply chain that we look for. I think it's an umbrella of, you know, soft skills and things that we look for. Of course, we want to see that you're interested, right, in the supply chain area. Like if you have experience working in a professional setting, great. But I think overall, we have those umbrella of soft skills that we look for that, you know, help you stand out?
We would definitely echo off of that that answer. Relevant experience. Again, we don't expect you to have worked in a supply chain in the past, but if you've taken courses, if you have been exposed to particular technologies or systems that are used within supply chain, even if it's not the exact technology that we use, we'll likely use a similar product to that. So long as you have that familiarity, you know enough to be dangerous, we can definitely supplement the rest.
Great, thank you. Next question from Amanda. What are your takes on accepting OPT, CPT, potentially sponsoring candidates? So this would be for our international students.
At PetSmart, we're a case-by-case basis. It's happened in the past. It's certainly a little easier in some areas where the skill sets are a little bit more niche, but we definitely engage all students and ultimately cross that bridge when we get there.
Yeah, for us, it's the same. More of our, I would say, technology spaces, we would more so sponsor. But for like our corporate roles, it's not something that's common, but again, it's case by case basis.
And at Ross, we do not sponsor at the intern or entry level. No sponsorship.
Great. Thank you all. Next question from Miranda. Are there any full-time opportunities for marketing students graduating in December?
At this time, not that I'm aware of, but the best way to stay up to date on those roles would be to go on to our career site at careers.nordstrom.com, create a profile, and then set up alerts for your areas of interest. That way, when roles are posted, you'll be alerted and then you can go in and apply.
We are hiring for full-time assistant buyers and assistant planners. And it would be for a start date sometime early 2024.
Yeah, so for us, it would be the customer experience rotational program or the digital rotational program, depending on what niche of marketing you're looking to go into. Both programs are 48 weeks and would not start until June of 2024. Outside of that, careers.petsmart.com, any entry-level role is definitely going to be posted on there. The typical recruitment timeframe takes between 6 to 10 weeks, depending on the role and depending on how urgent the hire needs to happen. That being said, definitely submit your application. And to Brittany's point as well, we also have talent pools that you can become a part of. So that way, as soon as any keywords or key areas or departments that you're looking to move into, if there are roles that are posted, you certainly can submit your application. In addition to that, those roles, if they're available as remote roles, will also be listed as such. But for the most part, our roles would be in Phoenix, Arizona.
Thank you all. One more question in the chat, then we're going to take some of our hands raised so we can meet some of our students as well. But Caprina asked, are there any internships in HR? Probably because you guys are all so great. So I'll let you guys answer that one.
For us, it's been something that's been talked about, I would say probably consecutively for the past 4 or 5 years. However, it is not up and running just yet. But we are hopeful that we'll have one soon, but at this time we don't.
Yeah, PetSmart, we are hiring for 2 HR internships, as well as an HR analytics internship that will likely work within our human capital solutions team. So for any of you data analytics students out there, this is a perfect example that data analytics is true and thriving in all departments. It's how we tell our story. It is how we get budgets approved. It's how we get projects greenlit. So if you have a passion for data, as well as any additional kind of space in the retail arena, definitely want to chat with you.
Unfortunately, we do not have an HR internship. My team has definitely tried to push for one in the past, but we don't have anything right now.
All right, let's go to some of our hands raised and meet some of our students here. So the first hand I see raised is Madeline. Madeline, you want to come and introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Madeline Stone. I go to the University of Tennessee. I'm a sophomore there currently, so I'm scheduled to graduate in 2026. And I'm in the supply chain major, so I'm interested in all the supply chain internships. And one thing I didn't really hear you guys talk about was your sustainability efforts, which is something I'm really interested in, especially in supply chain. So like what kind of sustainability efforts have y'all made in your companies that you think would be interesting, especially from a supply chain aspect, to hear about?
I think we're all going to our career pages. I'm not intimately aware of what we are, of what exactly we do at the supply chain level, at the granular level. However, there are several different sustainability efforts, whether it be recycling or reusing packaging, shipping materials, making sure that we are utilizing anything that's damaged or no longer viable to sell in store. For example, if a bag of dog food or a shipment of dog food is somehow damaged, the food itself is still consumable, but maybe the cans are dented or the bags have ripped, they will make sure that they are able to repackage that and salvage as much of the food. And then we donate it to our pet sustainability vendors through PetSmart Charities. That's also a big component of PetSmart Charities, but I won't go into that, about kind of helping close the gap between food insecurities as it relates to not just families, but to their pets. If you're having to choose between feeding yourself and your dog, that should not be a thing. So PetSmart Charities does a lot of great work to help in that space. And a lot of that goes through our DC and supply chain operations.
I would say a majority of our sustainability efforts occur within our distribution center. So, you know, very close to the supply chain aspect. We have specific heating and cooling systems. We have specific ways that we light up our distribution centers. You know, they are such huge facilities. So it's important that we're really focusing on that. And I would say just our business model inherently is sustainable. You know, we're not taking secondhand goods, but we are taking merchandise that might not have been sold elsewhere. Or, you know, maybe the vendor had produced too much of a specific product. You know, we are buying that and then selling that to our customers. So we're taking, you know, product that might have ended up in a landfill. We're taking that and selling it. So yeah, those are some of our sustainability efforts.
And I think for us, we kind of start with really small things that make a big impact. So like our famous silver gift boxes, like those are all made from recycled material. Even down to, you know, in-store shopping, right? And having the option to have a receipt emailed versus printed to reduce our carbon footprint. But then on a larger scale, I mean, last year we managed to keep 293 tons of clothing out of landfills through donation, resale, or refurbishment. And then take it a step further, like we took back almost 6 tons of beauty packaging through our beauty cycle program. And we won Good Housekeeping's 2021 Sustainable Innovation Award for that. So there's things that we're doing to reduce our carbon footprint because it's important to us for sure.
Great. Thank you all. And thank you, Madeline, for your question. All right. Next up, we have Cody.
Hi. My name is Cody Gallegos. I'm a senior fashion designer, fashion design major at Illinois State University. I'm graduating in this May 2024. I had a question for Brittany. Can you talk a little bit more about the fashion design program that you mentioned at the beginning? Are these open for graduating seniors? And also, what do the full-time roles at Nordstrom look like regarding design? Because I didn't know previously that they had a design area at all. So that's cool to hear.
Yeah, so for our fashion design internship, this is something that is actually really new to us. This will be our very first cohort for this summer, but you need to be a current junior to be considered for the program. You'll get like an up close behind the scenes view of like, you know, the industry that you kind of won't get in a classroom setting. By supporting our designers with all functions, categories, brands, including like, you know, collab prepping, sketching, color CADs. You'll work alongside and learn from experienced members of the design and on a design project. where you'll have milestones, deliverables, and deadlines that you'll get to present directly to our company leadership at the end of the summer. And then you'll also get to focus on customer and researches to better understand like our customer, our trends, shifts in competitive landscapes. And then you'll be able to build just great relationships, stellar communication and follow through. There are some things that you'll need to be proficient in, like MS Office Suite, Adobe CS, the ability to hand sketch, and then just kind of quickly adapt to new technology and systems as well. So I can post a link in the chat with the job that'll take you to the job description, and then you can kind of see if it's something that you're interested in, if that works for you.
All right. Our next question is from Jenna.
Hi, my name is Jenna Walker, and I'm a sophomore at the University of Arizona majoring in retailing and consumer science. And I know a lot of the internships are looking for current juniors. I'm a sophomore. I was just wondering if you had any advice for sophomores applying to internships and how to really stand out.
I think it's great to attend events like this one. Kudos to you for showing up. You know, I think any sort of networking event you can go to, any career related events, so the career fair, any talks that you know, a retailer or a recruiter that is attending your school, you know, definitely attend those. I would say really just start to build that network, you know, and reach out to recruiters, you know, follow up. And then, you know, when it comes time to apply as a junior, you'll already have those connections and they'll be much more likely to start up the conversation with somebody who really kept up that relationship, really kept up with the connection, you know, than someone who might not have.
I would say to also look into companies that have what they call is like early identification programs. Typically, those are geared towards sophomores because the whole idea behind those programs is to kind of give you a glimpse of, one, what the company would be like, but two, they help professionally develop you to be ready for an internship, whether it's with that company or elsewhere. We actually do have a program like that, and it's called Inspire. And it's like a boot camp style program. It's 1 week long, it's paid. And so applications for that will open up in January. But I'd say, yes, look into companies that have early identification programs.
At PetSmart, we don't have a firm kind of like no sophomores rule or anything like that. So we definitely encourage everyone to apply. We have hired sophomores in the past. And what typically happens there with successful internship completions, we will still extend an offer, but we'll extend the offer for a return internship. Some interns choose to take us on that offer. Others don't. I think there's a value in being able to compare and contrast. But the beautiful thing about being able to come back for a second internship, you're already familiar with the organization. You're likely familiar with leaders within your sphere of influence. But then on top of that, if your interests are a little bit more niched, or maybe you were exposed to an internship or a department that you're incredibly passionate about, voice that during the offer stage. What we've done in the past, I can think of a couple different IT interns where this worked out really well for them. We had an IT analyst intern who at the end of her first internship with our information security team, loved the team, but was really passionate about big data. So for her second internship, she expressed that, and we specifically placed her in a big data internship for her second internship. She graduated this past May and is now in a full-time role on the big data team. So it definitely does happen, but I would just say, make sure that your resume speaks to your experience, your learning agility, as well as kind of where you're looking to go.
Perfect. Thank you all for that. I know there were a couple questions in the chat about sophomore underclassmen advice and guidance. So that is all really helpful. All right. Next, we have Lily.
My name is Lily Madison. I'm a junior at the University of Alabama, majoring in fashion merchandising, on track to graduate in May 2025. This question might be have a similar answer to like the resume questions and stuff, but when you're browsing through LinkedIn, like what keywords are you guys searching? What sticks out on a profile? And then when it comes to direct messages, like which ones are you most likely to respond to? Or do you guys tend to go through all of them and like get back to everyone?
This may sound kind of chaotic, but I get back to everybody. That seems really like a heavy ask. But again, our program is pretty boutique with only 39 internships. We still get a good amount of applications, obviously, and application traffic. But definitely depending on, I mean, I don't really rely a whole lot on the content of your LinkedIn beyond verifying what's on the verifying what's on the resume, or if there's maybe any supplemental information on your LinkedIn profile. Recommendations and endorsements are a huge are pretty solid for me anyway. If you are able to impact your peers, your professors to the point where they leave you a recommendation or an endorsement on your profile, that definitely helps. But definitely ask questions, ask for what you need. There is no such thing as a stupid question. So please always ask. As a first gen student, I was very, very in the dark. My dad was a line cook. My mom was a stay at home mom. So to ask any internship related questions, I'm incredibly passionate about, because again, you just don't know what you don't know, right? And every company is going to be slightly different. There might be a nuance that exists at one company that doesn't exist at another. So just always being transparent, and I realize vulnerability is a big ask for a lot of people, myself included, but if that helps you make a more informed decision or helps you really wholeheartedly go after and pursue an opportunity, please always ask.
Yeah, I would say sending like, you know, those messages on LinkedIn, it can be a little intimidating, right? Because you might not necessarily know what to say, but I feel like, you know, if your message comes across the right person, like, they're going to answer it, right? So like, I definitely pride myself as well on answering everyone. I don't care if it's a week later, like I'm going to apologize for my delayed response. And then I'm going to get to your question. You know, in addition, like I recognize that I am not the expert on everything. But I will do, you know, what's in my power to get you to the right person, or at least point you in the right direction of someone that can better answer the question. So I'd say, you know, for you, continue to have the courage to send those messages, and, you know, don't let, you know, a lack of response or no response kind of deter you from not send the message.
All right. We're coming up soon on time. So we're going to take one more live question. And then right now I will say, recruiters, if you feel comfortable or want to share any contact information in the chat, whether it be a LinkedIn or an email or any general email, maybe where students can continue to ask questions, please feel free to. We have a lot of questions. I think a lot of excited students, which is so great. And I wish we had an extra hour to get through them all. But students, we really appreciate your enthusiasm. And then recruiters, anything you can share in the chat, or if you want to quickly scan through and answer anything quickly, feel free to. But with that, let's take one more live question, and we have Abby.
Hello, my name is Abby Antoine, and I'm a junior at the University of North Carolina. I'm currently a fashion and textiles brand management student. My question, I would say, is more directed towards Samantha for Ross Stores, but I'm also open to hearing from Manuel and Brittany if anything opens up. So what would the typical role of a buying intern look like, or like the day-to-day for them?
Sure. So our program's 8 weeks long. It's over the summer. And each intern is assigned to a specific team and has a manager and a buddy within that team. So the manager is usually a buyer, and the buddy is an assistant buyer. And basically, the first 3 or 4 weeks, you're really in trainings. So you're in kind of a classroom style training. You are learning about, you know, Ross's business model. You're learning about how we operate, the different systems that we use, ways that we buy, different tactics that we use. You're kind of diving into the analytical piece in those systems trainings. You know, there's an Excel training, a retail math training. So you're kind of learning in a classroom setting, and then you are applying with your team. So then you are working directly with your team. You're learning how it relates directly to your specific product category. You are shadowing, you're reverse shadowing, you're having one-on-one trainings. And then halfway through the summer is really when you start to actually apply all those trainings to real work. And you are up and running as a mini assistant buyer. So you are running reports on Mondays, you're analyzing the business, you're helping prepare for market appointments. You actually get to go to market appointments, meet with vendors face-to-face, you get to see product. And then at the end of the summer, there is a project that all of our interns participate in and then present their project to their team. So it is really just a great way to kind of bring everything together, kind of put everything into practice that you've learned throughout the summer. And there's also, you know, not so role specific experiences that the interns will get as well. So we have a speaker series throughout the summer where you'll get to learn about different areas of Ross and different, you know, initiatives that we have. We have lots of different networking opportunities and team building events for our interns, so they really get to meet one another. But it's really hands-on and structured internship program. So that's kind of what the buyers are doing day to day throughout the program.
I would definitely echo that. The projects that you're going to be working on as an intern here are individual to your specific space. I don't know if anyone noticed at the beginning other than Andrew. Andrew Roth is on the call today, and he was actually a summer 2023 intern here at PetSmart in the buying space. That's why I called him out earlier. But even like, for example, this year, we will have three buying interns. One will focus on hard goods, which are all the things that you can expect around like leashes, leads, dog bowls, beds, things of that nature, consumables, which are pretty self-explanatory. And then our specialty department, which involves everything that's basically not dog and cat related. So think birds, hamsters, reptiles, fish. And you're individually working on a project for that team. The project that you present at the end of the summer is very, it's geared to be very actionable, to be implemented. Dashboards have been created by interns and implemented. Our integration with Alexa was a few summers back was elevated through the work and project of an intern. So we really look for you to really immerse yourself in meaningful projects here at PetSmart to really present to our senior leaders for actual consideration. You're not just working on some fun fluff piece that'll get you through 10 weeks, right?
Thank you so much, Abby, for that question. Hopefully that helped. And with that, we're just a little bit over time. So we are going to go ahead and wrap up today's recruiter chat. Thank you so much to Manuel, Samantha, and Brittany for your participation. I think it was a really great conversation. We really appreciate your time and all of your insights. As a reminder, we have recruiter chats tomorrow and Wednesday, as well as next week, Monday through Thursday, and then the virtual career fair on October 6th, where all three of these companies will be in attendance and you'll get the chance to talk to them one-on-one. So really great opportunity there. It's also free to sign up for, so make sure that you do that. And then check out Fostering Diverse Connections as well. Our job listings page is being updated regularly. So be sure to check that out as you're looking for jobs, and then keep an eye out for more information about the NRF Foundation Student Program Conference in January. Registration is open for that. So we hope to see you there as well. With that, thank you so much, everyone. Thank you to our panelists. Thank you to our students. And I hope you all have a very wonderful evening.